Savitri notes and comments, hymn of ignorance and fate. Let us look at the following sentence, which appears at the early beginning of the Book of Fate. Book of Fate, Canto 1, sentence number 7. The text as we have of this sentence in the 1951 edition of Savitri is like this. A change felt upon the singer's mood, a rapture and a pathos moved his voice. He sang the word of light that never fades, and wondrous and pure everlasting bliss. He sang the word, the deathless heart of love. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fame. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fame. Hymn of ignorance and pain. But the first line of this sentence, a change felt upon the singer's mood, has only 9 syllables in it, and it cannot be scanned as a pentameter. The second foot is short of 1 syllable. Other 4 feet are iambs. A change felt upon the singer's mood. The second foot with just 1 syllable is quite limping. Other 4 feet are iambs. Grammatically also, the verb felt looks very much odd, carrying no direct sense. A change felt upon mood. However, this line in the 1954 edition of Savitri, the university edition of Savitri, and all the subsequent editions of Savitri, the centenary edition and the revised edition, have a different reading. A change now fell upon the singer's mood. A change now fell upon the singer's mood. Felt has been changed to now fell. Prosodically and grammatically, this is a perfect line scanning as follows. A change now fell upon the singer's mood. 4 iambs with second foot as a spondee, now fell. But this spondee, now fell, could also be taken as an iamb, now, not really carrying that much accent here, or else as a weak spondee. Amal Kiran, it is he who had essentially edited the 1954 edition of Savitri, the university edition of Savitri, and we do not know if he made that change, felt change to now fell, purely for metrical grammatical reasons. We do not know if there is any support from the manuscripts. In the absence of it, this will be an editorial emendation. But possibly, he might have checked the original papers. This book, the Book of Fate, had received the last revision by Shevendro in November 1950. Absolutely the last work he had done on Savitri, when he had added 3 new passages. Passages in the second canto. During that phase, drafts were quite heavily revised. There is a fascicle of this canto, published before his passing away in December 1950. Of this fascicle, the publishers say, all rights reserved, first published in 1950. This was revised perhaps in July 1950. This fascicle was revised in July 1950. Yet there is a pretty good ground to assume that in the process of analyzing the text, errors or slips had occurred. This could be while taking down the dictations or while typing. If a dictation is written over an earlier one, there is likelihood of the typist misreading it. It will be therefore pertinent to know what exactly we have in the manuscripts. Archives publications are rather silent about it. Nowhere the details are given. But we also have a similar situation in another sentence, just following this sentence, two sentences after this, sentence number 109. He sang the inconscient and the secret cell. His power omnipotent, knowing not what it does, all shaping without will or thought or sense. His blind unerring occult mystery and darkness yearning towards eternal light and love that brews within the dim abyss and waits the answer of the human heart. And death that climbs immortality, and death that climbs immortality, and death that climbs immortality. This line also is short of a syllable. It has only 9 syllables. The last line, and death that climbs immortality, is again short of a half foot. Is it death that climbs immortality, or is it death that climbs to immortality or climbs towards immortality? With two, the line scans as follows, and death that climbs to immortality. I am Pyrrhic, and death that climbs to immortality. Both these changes were made in the 1954 edition. The revised edition of 1993 retains them without any explanation or comment how the 1954 was revised. Undoubtedly, there is something not right with these 1951 lines, both these lines. Something not right with them. We shall try to look into some of these aspects. There could also be other imaginative considerations, such as, and death that climbs new immortality, and death that climbs bright immortality, and so on. These adjectives would give us different kind of death, conveying a happier, auspicious sense of the process. There would be in it richness and wisdom of the divine working itself. A full imaginative play is possible, but wild conjectures are not a pleasing thing with a work like Savitri, and this must be set aside. The question is about death climbing immortality or climbing to immortality. Let us look into what the dictionary says about the verb climb. Verb climb, without object, to go up or ascend, especially by using the hands and feet only, or feet only. To rise slowly by or as if by continued effort. To ascend or rise. To slope upward with object, to ascend, go up or get to the top, especially by the use of the hands and feet, or feet alone or by continuous or strenuous effort. To climb a rope, to climb the stairs, to climb a mountain, to go to the top of and over, to go to the top of and over. The prisoners climbed the wall and escaped. The British climb is essentially an intransitive verb, verb without object. But in the transitive form, there is another fullness of significance also. All this could be argued if that too has nowhere any textual support in the Savitri papers. But let us be concerned with the facts. In both the lines, the revised text of 1954 is correct. Chit version and Nero's handwritten version, chit version in Savitri's own hand and copy of it in Nero's hand. These two versions read as, a change had fallen upon the singer's mood. A change had fallen upon the singer's mood. When Nero's copy was read out to Savitri, this line was revised to, a change now fell upon the singer's mood. Regarding the line, death that climbs to immortality, it is clear that climb towards immortality was revised to climb to immortality. Two earlier chit-pat versions are, and death that climbs to immortality, and death that climbs towards immortality. And Sri Aurobindo's dictated version in Nero's copy reads as, and death that climbed to, verse struck off, immortality, I capital changed to small I, immortality. These two instances, change failed, change now fell, climbs immortality, climbs to immortality, are good examples of the slips made by the typist. It is also obvious that typed text was not proofread. All that makes editing of Savitri a pretty complex affair. The full text of death climbing to immortality, climbing to immortality, not towards but to immortality, becomes into the eternal life and love that brews within the dim abyss and weighs the answer of the human harm and death that climbs to immortality. In this description, there is a strong visible echo of the following Upanishadic prayer. Prayer which need not be considered as a prayer, but as an assertion in the evolutionary manifestation. Asato ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityor ma amrutam gamaya. Lead us from falsehood to truth, from darkness to light, from death to immortality. There is no question of towards here. It is to, from darkness to light, from death to immortality, from falsehood to truth. It is to, with an ecstatic affirmation, so too it is in, and darkness yearning to the eternal light, and love that brews within the dim abyss, and weighs the answer of the human harm, and death that climbs to immortality. Let us scan these lines, and darkness yearning towards the eternal light, and love that brews within the dim abyss, and weighs the answer of the human heart, and death that climbs to immortality. In these 20 syllables, We have 18 ayams and only 2 piriks. Naras master stroke, as far as the prayer is concerned, vis-a-vis the Sanskrit prayer is, and love that brews within the dim the pain and waits the answer of the human heart. What beautiful lines. And almost all ends. Darkness yearns towards eternal light and death climbs to immortality. Darkness yearns towards eternal light and death climbs to immortality. Because there is love that brews within the dim abyss. Darkness yearns towards eternal light. Death climbs to immortality because there is love that brews within the dim abyss. There is a difference between darkness yearning towards light and death climbing to immortality with a greater assertion in the second. But we must also seek the relevance of something else. It is a hymn of ignorance and fate. It is a hymn of ignorance and fate. The relevance of the hymn, the relevance of hymn of ignorance and fate should also be understood. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fate. The full sentence is, a change now fell upon the singer's mood. A rapture and a pathos moved his voice. He sang the vow of light that never wanes, and oneness and pure everlasting bliss. He sang the vow, the deathless heart of love. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fame. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fame. His chant was a hymn of ignorance and fame. That surprisingly makes ignorance and fate. Ignorance and fate a chant, a praise of ignorance and fate. That makes surprisingly something different. That surprisingly makes ignorance and fate stupendously great. A hymn, a praise, idolizing ignorance and fate, something which otherwise is deeply feared. But how is it a song of praise, a song of praise, a hymn? How is it an applause of ignorance and fate? Let us look at Thomas Gray's fragment entitled Hymn to Ignorance. Oh, say, she hears me not, but careless groan, lethargic nods upon her ebon throne. Goddess, awake, arise! Alas, my fear, can powers immortal feel the force of fear? Not thus of old, with ensigns wide and firm, she rode triumphant o'er the vanquished world. Fierce nations owned her unresisted might, and all was ignorance, and all was night. These are the last 4 couplets of Gray's short piece entitled Hymn to Ignorance. This was published after his death by his editor, William Bisson. Here is the editor's note. Though I have said that Mr. Gray, on his return to Cambridge, laid aside poetry almost entirely, yet I find amongst his papers a small fragment in verse which bears internal evidence that it was written about this very time. It seems to have been intended as a hymn or address to ignorance, and I presume, had he proceeded with it, would have contained much good satire upon false science and scholastic pedantry. What he writ of it is purely introductory. Yet, many of the lines are so strong and the general cast of the versification so musical that I believe it will give the generality of readers a higher opinion of his poetic talents than many of his lyrical productions have done. I speak of the generality because it is a certain fact that their taste is founded upon the 10-syllable couplets of Dryden and Pope, and upon that only. It is obvious that the poem is a poet's quest for his tutelary spirit, for the muse who will preside over the making of poetic and personal identity. In it melt horrors, gloomy bowers, gothic fanes, antiquated tower, delusive rays, but hives of hoarded sweets have yet to be found, and the display of painted plumage yet to be seen. The expectations of the youth have remained unfulfilled. The impression is, for the poet, the sun is set, the spring is gone. The rays none yet in bright and shining garments to give him company and consolation. The youthful years have already passed, hurriedly. There is an undercurrent of melancholy with the poet sitting in the company of the muse, sitting by the riverside, his youth already flown. Some of the lines are poetically very striking, such as, "Can powers immortal feel the foes of him? Can powers immortal feel the foes of him? Can powers immortal feel the foes of him?" She rode triumphant o'er the vanquished world. Can powers immortal feel the foes of him? She rode triumphant o'er the vanquished world. They have a discernible overt quality. They bring into melancholy the soaring power of silence, of deep spiritual calm. But as a hymn to ignorance, it remains infructuous. The poem remains infructuous. As a hymn to ignorance, it remains infructuous. On the other hand, the Rigveda hymn tonight, Ratri Sukta, Mandala 10, Sukta 127, hymn tonight at once speaks of night as a goddess, sister of dawn, night and dawn as sisters, day the daughters of heaven. Night decked with splendor drives away the darkness. At her approach, men, beasts, and birds go to rest. She approaches her worshippers from the wolf and the thief, guiding them to safety. Night appears as a dual divinity with dawn, occurring in some 20 scattered stanzas of the Rigveda. But that may be the greatness of the divine night, a night in the glory of heaven. Here on earth, we have a different night, a different picture of night and death and ignorance. In Savitri, night is she who gives protection to death, death. Who is the cause of all error and falsehood? Death is on the verge of being vanquished and seeks shelter and safety in the night. but she refuses. Knight refuses. He calls her, but she falls shuddering back. But finally, he takes refuge in her. That is her divinity. But death taking refuge in the retreating knight is not death climbing to immortality. That kind of immortality is given to him by divine Savitri herself. Death climbing to immortality, that divinity is given to him by divine Savitri. She who alone can do it. I hail thee, almighty and victorious death, thou grandeur, darkness of the infinite. Thou art my shadow and my instrument. Live, death, awhile, be still my instrument. One day, man too shall know thy fathomless heart of siren and the brooding peace of night and grave obedience to eternal law and a calm, inflexible pity in thy gaze. I hail thee, almighty and victorious death, thou grandeur, darkness of the infinite. Thou art my shadow and my instrument. Live, death, awhile, be still my instrument. One day, man too shall know the fathomless heart of siren and the brooding peace of night and grave obedience to eternal law and the dim, inflexible pity in thy gaze. He is her instrument. Death is Savitri's instrument, the divine Savitri's instrument, and it is in it that, and it is in that role that he is climbing not just towards immortality, but to immortality. He is climbing not just towards immortality, but to immortality. It is not death who is climbing to immortality, but immortal death himself who is climbing back to immortality. This is deathless immortality of death. It is brooding peace that makes night the daughter of heaven. The brooding peace makes night the daughter of heaven. It justifies praise to her. It justifies praise to her.